After singing, I said, well, let's figure out something. Timmy was like, we just want you to produce it. And then Aaron was like, I don't know if I want to do that, you know. I don't want to be in a two-man group. I'll do it if he's in it. And he was talking about me. That was the start of us developing. We didn't even have the name Guy.
All right, everybody that's tuned in, y'all know my slogan already. I don't do interviews. I only have conversations. When I came from Haiti, I would say the best knowledge that I got was actually not the books that was given to me in school. It was actually the guys that was in the corners. They was like, hey man, did you read this book? I said, no, it's the Egyptian Book of the Dead. In Harlem, a lot of like great legends rise. And I don't use this word lightly, like musical genius, child prodigy, somebody that was chosen for the time. Their relevancy is just based on frequency. I learned that word from Santana. It means that they will forever be here. So the great, the one and only, Teddy Riley.
What up,
what up, family? Listen to that voice, man. You got that voice that every producer envies. You know, your voice is the best sampled voice in the world.
Thank you, man. You know, people grew on my voice because I hated my voice. I really hated my voice. You know, and when Aaron taught me how to sing, he was one of the people that got me to start liking my voice. Because he showed me how to articulate it with notes. A lot of people don't know that we all speak in notes. We all speak, when we speak, we actually move in notes. And a lot of people just don't know that, that they're singing every day.
Yo, you're like such a genius that even when you talk, now I'm gonna be like, so Mr. Teddy Riley. Yo, you mentioned Aaron. So let me finish that up. Aaron Hall, consider this the most sexiest music tutorial that y'all about to have right now, because at times we'll stop, I'll play a record and we'll get back into it. Teddy, the idea of creating this group Guy, I remember Aaron Hall, because you literally birthed a complete sound. When we talk about R&B and we talk about the sound of New Jack Swing, I gotta say that again. Everybody pay attention, because every genre has a creation of a sound. So my daughter is in the trap generation right now, right? I was in the boom bap generation. That's like saying the Big Bang Theory. So we are on now with the scientists, the origin of New Jack Swing. So if you could go into the, what made you create an R&B group and what inspired this sound, man?
I was with a group before Guy. I created a lot of groups and then some things were formed around me. The first group was Kids at Work. And you all can look that up. But Kids at Work was the first group and it didn't work. So I'm like, when it comes to something not working, I never stop. I keep going with it. I'll try another one. So I'm probably the only producer that's been with more groups than anybody in the music industry.
Wow.
And that's going from a band that I was in called Total Climax. We had a record out, and then we did Kids at Work. And we had a record out, but that record didn't do well. But later on, we did it with Heavy D called Don't You Know. And then, getting into Guy. Guy, I don't take the full credit for developing all of this stuff. I have to give it to my best friend, Timmy Gatlin. And Timmy Gatlin was one of the guys who always brought me an idea. You know, I was just a producer then. He brought this one idea. He brought Aaron Hall to the studio while I was mixing Keith Sweat, I Wanna, a It was a power play. He's like, man, I want to introduce you to somebody. We're trying to put together a group. You know, it's just him and I, like Casey and JoJo. He just started singing behind it. Blew me away. I thought I was listening to Donny Hathaway meets Charlie Wilson meets Sam Cooke.
Talk.
After singing, I said, well, let's figure out something. Timmy was like, we just want you to produce it. And then Aaron was like, I don't know if I want to do that, you know. I don't want to be in a two-man group. Mm-hmm. I'll do it if he's in it. And he was talking about me. That was the start of us developing. We didn't even have the name Guy. Mm-hmm. And where we got the name from was a store on 125th Street called Two Guys. And it was right across the street from AJ wow. Lester's. Two Guys was the place when you can't afford AJ Lesser's, you go to Two Guys, and you know you get wow. the AJ Lesser's with the dots on the side, and the Playboys from Brooklyn, you know, or the British Walkers,
yeah, wow,
or Bally's, you know, whichever one you want to choose, you know, and we would have them in colors: red, light blue, purple. We did the purple. That's how we got the group color, Guy group. Color is purple. That's how we just started developing, you know, the group Guy, G-U-Y.
Wow. That, man. When I was asked to do a podcast, I said, I ain't doing no podcast because I don't interview artists because ain't really nothing to talk about. I said,
right.
But I can have a conversation with aliens all day because I'm just a studio nerd. So we share
are.
This, right? We share that similarity. And I'm someone who looks up to you. So I'm going to show you how much I look up to you before I go on. So the reason why my show is called Run That Back, every time one person is coming up, there's always kids watching them and they don't know it, right? So I literally right. was watching you. And when I was watching you, I was envisioning myself in the group already. I was working at Burger King at the time. So let me show you me and my brain infusing myself inside of the guy. I called up my man, Rod. I call him Eight Fingers, because that's how he plays. And I was like, yo, I want to infuse myself in Guy. And so imagine if we came out today, this is what it would sound like. Let me show you. I'm gonna play with you a little bit.
Okay.
Tell me what you like, girl. Tell me what you like, girl. Tell me what you like. Tell me what you like, girl. Tell me what you like, girl. Tell me what you like. Tell me what you like, girl. Tell me what you like, girl. Tell me what you like. I like. Tell me what you like, girl. Tell me what. I wanna know what you like. Tell me what you like, girl.
Fire.
I wanna know what you like.
Yeah, I need you to send this to me.
I did it just for you. paying homage to you. Yeah. That's me and my whole crew paying tribute to you, man.
We gotta finish that. it's needed. It's needed right now. It's needed right now. I guarantee you. Send it to me.
That's
and watch
all my- you, though. That's all you. All I did was my team, my man Rob. We got together, and this is all generations, right? Me, 20, we all get together, and we say, I tell my team, you know, it's Teddy. And earlier we talked about that frequency. So it's so important. Sometimes because you live in your body, you mm-hmm. just have to be reminded. This is just us reminding you, it doesn't matter what year and what time. That's classic material and it will live forever. So that was me, that was my gift to you, just so you know that how much you inspired. And I'm sure everyone that listening right now, from people that love R&B, that love Afrobeats, that love the Caribbean.
The reason why I want you to send it to me, I'm gonna tell you why. Cause I'm doing an album, right? These are the people I wanted on my album. And you were one of the names. And I said, we gotta do something. Like,
oh man, breaking news, this. run that back.
No, seriously, man. It's for my book, and which is called Remember the Time. So why I say Remember the Time, and why you fit the description of being one of the people on my album is, do you remember the first time we met? I bet you don't.
Hit Factory?
No.
Tell me.
The first time we met, you was in a van with your band, the Fugees, and y'all came in a van to Philadelphia.
Was it the Roots concert?
No, it was your concert and ours. Yeah. It was Black Street and the Fugees. And y'all came with the band, with the drums, with the drums in the van, and the guitars.
Yes, we always would be carrying our instruments, yes.
Let me tell you something. I told Maddie, I said, I got to tell him. He probably don't even remember.
But
I was so intrigued.
That's crazy.
With y'all getting out of the van with the drum set.
Yes, we would walk with our own church
yes,
equipment.
Yes.
Yeah, we came straight from Newark with that church equipment.
I seen this little short girl. She was like, yeah, we about to do it. I was like, yo, that's the girl from the TV, the movie.
The sister.
And I said, yeah. And I was like, yo, this is about to be smashing. And I didn't even think about Black Street. I was like, yo, I need to see this. And when y'all got on that stage, I was like, wow, we got to follow this? We up here with this beautiful music before I let you go and all that. I was like, yo, we got to follow that? And y'all was killing them. I was like, wow. Yeah. But it was amazing meeting you and Plies and Lauren and who was with y'all? What's the light skin kid who put
Hassan Sharif, Muslim brother.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Hassan Sharif.
Because he the one who brought me over to meet you.
Yeah, Hassan Sharif, my Muslim brother, yeah. But you know, we always like insanely fans. I mean, as you could tell, like we've all leveled off, but as you can see, your contribution to this as it continues. You did say something, you mentioned the word remember the time. And I have to ask you about Michael Jackson, but I'm probably gonna ask you in a way that no one has asked you about him. So Michael Jackson called me and I hung up the phone on him. So this is how the story went down, right? So
okay.
I was like, I'm like the prankster of my crew, always been. You know what I'm saying? So back in the days, we at the in Jersey, and my phone goes off, and somebody go, hello? And I say, yeah, who this? Michael Jackson, get the fuck out of here. Teddy, I hang up the phone, because I'm just like, yo, ain't nobody gonna get me. Like, I'm the original Ashton Kutcher. Ain't nobody punking me. So,
right.
Dude calls back, and it's Michael Jackson. And I freak out, and he's telling me that he's in Asia, and his record comes on called Gone to November, and he sees these violins. He's describing the entire video, and he's just like, yo, I need to work with this guy. So Michael now comes to New York. I think his bodyguard name was Skip at the time.
Yep, Skip.
And then, as you know, because you're like the guru of the studios, whether if it's Hit Factory or different. So the secret elevator in the back, Michael Jackson comes up, and my whole crew, and we meet Mike for the first time. And I literally lost my voice. I mean, you know, I try to be all cool. I was like, how you doing, Mr. Michael Jackson? And I completely, like, bitched up, like, yo, and let me tell you, and you said remember the time. If you was to, because we wasn't there with you when you was in there doing, you know, what became like the big comeback album, the craziness. What, you know, the when I say craziness, meaning the craziest comeback that I watched. How was Michael Jackson? Like, can you give us like a little something that you haven't given anyone? We'd really, really want to know about a little bit about the King of Pop.
Well, I can take you to so many things, but one thing in particular, when I was, my first time meeting him was over the phone, and he actually thought I was in California, ready to work. So his management at that time didn't tell him the truth. You know, they was like, we got the guy. We got Teddy Riley. We have him. He's here. So Michael got excited. And when I got on the phone with him, well, first of all, you remember Harvey Austin, my manager at the time.
Yes.
Well, Harvey was the one that answered the phone for Sandy Garland. And when Sandy Garland put Michael on the phone, he did the same. He turned into a girl. You know how his voice is. Hey, what's up? What's up, everybody?
Yeah.
And then when Michael got on the phone, he's like, I think that's him.
The Michael effect.
And when I talked to him, he said, Teddy? I said, yeah, Michael. He said, are you here? I'm like, no, there where? Are you in California? I'm like, no, I'm not in California. He said, I thought you were here. And then he pulled the phone from his ear. I thought you told me it was here. And they were like, no, he's coming. And he was talking to me, and when he talked to me, he said, you know, I really, really want to, I want to ask you a question. And this is a question I didn't know until I heard from other people. He asked everyone, do you love music? And he goes into the do you love music, and he said, how much you love it? And you have to actually answer that. Because I feel like if you don't, I feel like he would have no interest in you.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Facts.
So when I express my love for music, he's like, well, I feel somewhat the same way. You know, do you dream about it? I'm like, of course, I dream music every day. Music is all the way my dream. It's like there's nothing that could take me away from my dream. That's the reason why, you know, I'm solo, I'm single, you know, and He's like, oh, you're single. I'm like, yeah. He's like, so you do love music. Because I'm single, I love music.
Wow.
And it was just the most incredible, like, honest conversation. Like, I didn't know if I needed to be honest or lie to him, you know. But I told him, you know, basically how I felt about music. And he was just so intrigued. And then when I finally went to the Netherlands, you know, I was there too long. I thought, you know, we was going to get there, kick it, then go to the studio. I didn't see the studio for like seven, maybe 10 days. And I got so, you know, like, antsy. I wasn't bored because he had everything. I just got antsy. Like, I want to get to the music.
Yeah.
Let me see if I made the cut. You know what I'm saying? Like,
facts.
It's like, you don't know if you made the cut and you playing games with him and hide-go-seek and going to the movie theater and then the zoo and then everything, just everything at the Netherlands. And, you know, putting on these doggone Moonwalker robes.
Moonwalker robes?
Yeah, and the candy bar in your room, you know, because I spent the night and he had, like, a guest house with, like, I think it's, I don't know how many rooms. I just went to my room, but I seen other rooms.
Talk. And
it was just like, wow. So I'm walking the room and I see the toothbrush Moonwalker. I see the toothpaste Moonwalker. Candy bar Moonwalker. Robe Moonwalker. Slippers Moonwalker. Bedspread Moonwalker.
Wow.
I was like, I'm blown away. So he comes and knocks on my door and he said, you ready? I was like, okay, where we going? He said, we're gonna go to the game room first. And it's so crazy, you have that Pac-Man machine right there. He had tons of those doggone things all in the game room. And it was just insane, you know, just seeing him live his life as a kid again.
Wow.
So
it's amazing,
that was the
most
incredible thing. And then seeing his room, you know, with all of his awards and all of the amazing, like, from Oscars to Grammys after Grammy after Grammy, as far as your eye can see.
Facts.
You gotta say this guy is beyond a genius. You know, he's beyond a genius. You know, I have many stories, but I'm saving it for my book because everybody's been asking, are you gonna tell his stories in your book? And I said, just the stories that, you know, he would allow me to tell.
We touched by that because it's like, we always hear like Michael Jackson, like, a lot of things, like, he could, you know, he sees it, like, he relives his childhood. And literally, I was going from room to room to room to room with you, with Michael. When he came to see us at the studio, before he got in, you know me, I'm part of the Shatta gang. So everybody's in the studio. There's a lot of ganja, you know what I'm saying? Smoke everywhere.
Yeah.
And then we hear Michael Jackson's coming. Dude, you had to see how quick everybody was trying to put the smoke out and all kind
get rid of the smell.
Cause you know, you're the man that come in right now, be a Jehovah Witness. Y'all clean up everything, yo. And I'll never forget, yo, I'm with Mike, cause he wanted to see me by myself real quick. He's like, you remind me of a guy when we was younger and we used to go to Jamaica. And I'm like, dad, he probably saying that because he probably smelled all that weed in the other room. Then I was like, who, Bar Marley? Because I know when the Jackson 5 that went. He said, no, not Bar Marley. And I was trying to, then I was like, oh, Peter Tosh. He was like, yes, Peter Tosh. So it was crazy. He was telling me about like when they went to Jamaica, how much of a great time that they had out there. And it was definitely deep. But when I hear you speak, Teddy, similar to Michael Jackson though, you had success at a very young age, dude. And my thing is, watching you and Babyface on Verses, and y'all broke the internet until today, there's no Verses in existence that has come up with memes like that, that has matched that. Y'all completely discombobulated the internet in half. And it showed us something, right? So it showed the world at the end of the day, real will always be real. So sometimes people are constantly worried, billboard, radio, the internet shows us none of that really matters, right? Because right. Everyone is still well, they're alive, they're in tune, and they're gonna show up for the real shit. So I'm looking at you, listening to you, who like Michael, like you had success at a very young age still, and to see you on Verses, where it doesn't matter the generation, like you translate, meaning like it don't matter if there was fuck ups, y'all come back the next day and make it bigger than the first days, like more memes on you. You take the memes, you turn them into fun music, and all of a sudden, you know how artists take themselves so seriously within this generation? Like you literally mm-hmm. showed at the end of the day, if you're having a good time and it is about the music and it's about the fans, who give a fuck? My question for you, and we all want to know, and everybody that's listening, upcoming artists, we all need this from you. What is the secret to the balance? How do you stay so balanced?
I think it's more so the surroundings, you know. It's really about the surroundings for me. You know, my children, my mother, you know, she's here with me. Her dream was to be, you know, come out to Vegas, and I wound up making it my mission to bring her here, you know. And it's really about the surroundings, the vibe, you know. When you come out here, you'll see and you'll understand why and what makes me still go. You know, it's like I'm still on go. You've seen us. I mean, we did the Essence Festival together, and
what amazing, know, man. Essence Festival, man, you brought everybody out, bro.
It was amazing. The most incredible. Y'all made my life, you know, and then right behind that, you know, just seeing all of my friends on one stage, it's the most incredible feeling, especially in the flesh, because you rarely get that in the flesh.
Facts.
Most times people get it when they're gone. And I just say, you know, I'm just so grateful to still be here and receive the flowers, you know. And the other thing is, I never got caught up, you know, in the industry, mm-hmm. you know. So that's the thing, you know. I was never about the music industry. I was about the music. You know, I kind of took the industry out. That's the reason why sometimes I don't remember some of the things that, you know, I've done.
Wow.
You know, because, you know, that was industry. It's gone.
Wow. Well, yo, you already know we are going to take this with us. So I see, like, your pulse is crazy because I'm reading something. It says Korean music scene. And you always, like, have been international. Like you always are the cat. Like, I used to be like, well, if Teddy Riley's over here, we probably looking at the wrong place. We need to be looking there. And I know you have a lot of amazing things going on in Korea and in different parts with some of the biggest artists. So I speak a little Korean.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, I did.
What is it that you don't? What language so, you dude, don't speak?
Dude, I speak a little Korean. Anyang hashamika, right? That means how you doing? So, but I know you big in the scenes out there. I saw that, and I was like, yo, I gotta tell Teddy, like, a Korean person saved my life, dog. Like,
wow.
Yeah, so my daddy was a minister in Newark, New Jersey, South Orange Avenue. He built the church, and when you see the movie New Jersey Drive, that corner where you see the mm-hmm. cars pick up and go in 60 seconds, that's my corner. And across the street, my man named PK, he bought in the hood the first beauty supply store. And, you know, we was doing wow. the mischief stuff. And he was like, mm-hmm. you know what? Come in here and work for me. So one of my first jobs, and I would say that kept me out of the streets, I would go there from back in the church to the studio, was this Korean spot. And I sold hair. Now, Wyclef Jean worked in a beauty supply store. And dude's like, yo, you ain't gangster.
Wow.
You worked in a... I said, all the gangsters come from the beauty supply store. And they like, what do you mean? I'm like, listen, let me tell you something. Y'all don't understand. When I hit the Ave, and then I see a pretty girl, and then I could be like, okay, that's human hair versus that synthetic hair. You know, you using that Revlon, you might want to try that Precise. Oh, that Precise ain't it. You know, you might want to go with the cream of nature. Got him. I said, y'all don't understand. Gangsters are from the beauty supply stores. So yeah. I was like, I wanted to tell Teddy my story about, I have a lot of great friends from Korea. So, what is the scene like, and how did you end up in Korea, and what are you doing out there? And I know you haven't been to North Korea, though, I assume. You've been to the other side, right?
I've been to South. I haven't been to North.
All right, so you haven't seen Kim Jong-un yet?
Nah, I have not.
Cool. All right, breakdown.
I don't know.
Tell us
who
what's going
on. See him. Well, I lived out there 2 years, and
wow. Okay, tell us about.
Let me tell you how I went out there. I went out there because there was a company. I don't want to say the name of the company, but this company I did some music for, and they shysted me out of my writers. You know. My IP and you know, me and my partners, we wrote this song, you know, we wrote a couple of songs, and they took our publishing, and we were like, yo, we gonna go out to Korea,
yeah,
but we ain't gonna start no trouble, we just gonna go and tell them it's just not fair. And you know, when you say that to the Koreans, because they're so honorable and they're so like, they're so respectful. It's like this. When you say to them, this is something that, you know, I did for you in honor of, you know, your group and, you know, the Korean music culture. And I never thought that this would be something that would happen to us on our first time, you know, doing music for Korean artists. You know, you guys are not being fair. And they were like, whoa. You know, Mr. Teddy Riley, it's like, we want to make it right for you. And somehow they made it right. We got our publishing, but you can easily do music for Korean artists and your publishing can be taken and you'll never know about it. All you'll know is, you know, your record is on YouTube and it's got 100 million views. And you thinking you're getting paid for it, next thing you know, you're not. So...
Wow.
This one company, this one company, you know, did that to us. And then we met a dear friend of ours. His name is Taesung. And Taesung was the guy who helped us get with the right company. And that company is SM Entertainment. And that's where, you know, when we met them, we were 1 week from leaving. Mm. And they asked us, could we stay? Can we listen to some music? Can we, you know, meet with you? And that 1 week turned into a month. That month turned into 6 months. 6 months turned into 2 years.
Wow.
So yeah, so, I stayed out there until my best friend Heavy D passed away, and I said I better come back
to Heavy.
The States. You know, and when I came back to the States, I went to his funeral, his memorial. And then it's so crazy. I think it was him first, and then Michael, and then Gene Griffin. Mm-hmm. Passing right behind each other.
Wow, they said death comes in threes. RP to everybody, man, that passed.
So that was my Korean story, you know. We did a lot of records out there. I have over 6 or 7 number ones. And we just started, you know, just doing a bunch of music out there, and it became successful.
Wow. So I guess the tip to anyone that's listening, the youth that's coming up, keep in mind it's a big world, and literally do not limit yourself, because we listening to the great Teddy Riley, and that's incredible. So, you know, I know you're a busy man. I look forward. So this whole thing was inspired by a show I saw in London called Jews Holland, Live with Jews, because my thing was to get... Yeah, that's my inspiration. So I was like, yo, I want to get the musicians and everyone that I idolize, we just show up in a room and jam and just go crazy. So once things get better, I look to being in the same room with you with this instrument. You're going to have
one
your instrument. And then we do it again. I look forward to that. So as we let you go, if you had one song that we should all listen to right now, it could be anything. Because, you know, as producers, as composers, it's always one record that we heard, it changed our entire life of how we think. So for me, it was Miles Davis, Bitches Brew. Once I heard, like, sound like that, I was like, man, it adjusted my thinking. So if there's, like, one song or an album that we all should be listening to, something you would recommend, please let us know before you head out.
Well, for me, my favorite song in the whole wide world is Music and Me, mm-hmm, by Michael Jackson.
Okay.
You know, that was a song that gave me everything, a smile, an emotion, you know, a meditation. You know, music have been my imaginary friend. You know, when I was young, my parents didn't get along, and we used to always go, you know, when they would argue or fight, I would, you know, do the whole kid thing and go away. And it would be this imaginary friend called music, and it was always music.
Wow.
And I actually did an animation about it. You know, we're probably looking at putting it through one of the portals, but music was my savior. So music and me, when I heard that song, I always thought about my music, my imaginary friend. Now my wife.
That's my man, the great Teddy Riley. You already know we about to play that song. Teddy, I love you. I'll see you soon, family.
Love you too, man. And thank you for having me.
Thank you. Love you, family. All right, we back in Acoustic Sessions, catching a vibe. Let them know your name, fam. Hold
yo,
up.
Yo, yo, what's up? I go by T-Gut.
T-Gut, how's ASAP Ferg doing?
Oh, he's chilling, man. You know, just dropped the album, living life, doing his thing.
So, you know, I was talking to him a little bit back.
I saw that.
You're on the album, right?
Made a couple appearances.
Which songs?
I did Hectic and Puff. And then I did Aussie Freaks with 1-4 and Fivio.
That's dope. I was with Fivio, I think like 3 days ago.
Oh, shit.
You know at what age I met Fivio?
How old was he or how old were you?
How old he was?
Damn. 15?
9 years old.
Oh, shit.
East Flatbush.
Word.
Yeah, that's how long. I'm like a, like super, so, you know what I mean? But the good thing is, like, I'm like your friendly trapper. You know what I'm saying? So, you ever seen, like, that movie where Benny Blanco, like, shoots the OG from the Bronx? It's Carlito's Way. You never seen that? Oh, man, yo. You got to see Carlito's Way because Carlito, just say, like, he's an older gangster. You know what I'm saying? And then Benny Blanco's, like, the younger kid. And he just looks up to him. And he's like, yo, really? I'm, you know? And then Carlito just brushes him off, right? And that's his idol. And literally, he murders Carlito literally at the train station, right? The good thing with me is, like, ever since, like, these Benny Blancos, all they got is good things to say about me. They're like, Uncle Don, you came to Flatbush. He's Flatbush. You gave us love.
Warren,
you know what I'm saying? So it's all love. So one of the arts, man, which I'm part of, is the art of the DJ. And to me, this is an instrument all by itself. And so coming up, one of the things that we used to do in the neighborhoods, which I loved, was I would show up, shout out to my DJ, DJ Leon, monster. And the thing is, like when I'm playing with Jerry Wonder or whatever, I don't even need to look at you. It's almost like something that you do is going to give me a reaction of where I'm supposed to go with the melodies and all of that. So everyone who's watching this, we was off camera. He was like, yo, what should I do? Where should I go?
I didn't know anything.
Exactly. And that's, but when we showed up in the parks, that's what it used to be. We didn't really know anything. There was like, all we know was people are going to come and we got to make them feel good. So what I want to do is, on this acoustic vibe, is let's just make them feel good. And they're going to hear a medley like they've never heard it before. So you ready?
Let's get it.
All right, so I got to take myself, I got to put myself in a frame of mind like I'm back on either like Prospect Park, you know, that's in Brooklyn, or Elmwood Park, that's in New Jersey. You ready? Everybody's tuning in. Let's catch a vibe, man. Yeah. Welcome to the park. Check it out. I used to be in the park like this. Yeah, yeah. Ooh la la la. It's the way that we rock when we're doing our thing. Ooh la la la. It's the natural vibe that the refugees bring. Ooh la 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 la. Sweet thing. She love me like no other before. We used to be number 10. Now we permanent as one in the battle, lost my finger. Might became my arm, pistol nozzle hits a nasal. Blood becomes a warm teller, woman be easy not. Said I be, every time I make a rhyme, girl you turn around and cry. I ask myself why, oh why. See you must understand, I can't work no 9 to 5. So I'll be gone till November. Said I'll be going to November, I'll be going to November, yo. Yo, tell my girl, yo, I'll be going to November, I'll be going to November, I'll be going to November, yeah. Yo, tell my girl, yo, I'll be going to November. January, February, March, April, May. I say y'all crying, but girl, I can't stay. I'll be going to November, I'll be going to November, Kia is a captain, my shit, New York, surfies, eh. Moi do monsieur no mati, le bom yo kembo yo devo, c'est l'homme qui police vini. Moi do monsieur no mati, qui a ici captive marché New York surface. Moi do monsieur no mati, le bom yo kembo yo devo, c'est l'homme qui police vini. Moi do monsieur no mati, ready or not, here I come, you can't hide. Yeah, I'm gonna find you and beg you want me. Ready or not, here I come. You can't hide. I'm gonna find you. Now that I escape, sleep, walk awake. Those who cover late know the world ain't cake. Jail bars ain't golden gates. Those who fake, they break. When they meet their 400-pound mate, if I could rule the world, everyone would have a gun. In the ghetto, of course, when giddy up and on they horse, yo. I kick a rhyme, drinking moonshine. I pour a sip on the concrete for the deceased, but it's no, don't weep. Wyclef's in a state of sleep, thinking about the robbery that I did last week. Money in the bag, banker look like a drag. I wanna play with pelicans from here to Baghdad. Bow! Gun blasting fast, I think I'm hit. My girl pitched my hips to see if I still exist. I think not. I send a letter to my friends. A born again hooligan, only to be king again. Someone please call 911. Tell him I just been shot down. And the bullets in my heart, and it's piercing through my soul. Feel my body getting cold. So cold, so cold.
Put your hands up.
Someone please call 911. The seller was 5'1", and she shot me through my soul. Feel my body get cold, so cold, so cold. Yeah. I think they yelling remix. Keep the same rhythm. You want to hear another remix? Watch this. Hey, girl, I could see your body moving, and it's driving me crazy. And I didn't have the slightest idea until I saw you dancing. And when you woke up on the dance floor, nobody could not ignore the way you move your body, girl. And everything so unexpected, the way you right and left it. So you could keep on saying, I never really knew that she could dance like that. She make a man wanna speak Spanish. Como se llama bonita? Shakira, Shakira. Oh, baby, when you talk like, yeah. Welcome to the park. This is what we used to do in the park. I don't know where he going. He don't know where I'm going, but we just vibing. Lord knows, hey, oh. Ring the alarm, another sound is dying. We are the champion sound. Any other sound, I go dying. Yeah, ring the alarm, another sound of them are dying. Yeah, we are the number one sound. I them my colors in the champion. Yeah,
Jasper, I'm about to speak to Jasper. 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 Le pim went pitchy, went to Kita Haiti. Yes, I keep al booking, yes, I keep New York City. Pourquoi ça haïtien toujours dit c'est Jamaïque? Mais haïtien, y'a pas l'été, c'est haïtien. Pourquoi ça? Ou petit non, c'est Samuel. Pourquoi ça? Ou petit ou avec Israël. Pourquoi ça? Chaque soir, ou abdomi à Jezabel. Ou petit, femme haïtien, y'a que yo. Femme Nobel. Well, listen to them.
We want to thank y'all for rocking with us. This my homie right here. And that's what we call, that's how we do it in the parks. You know what I'm saying? So let's get up. This has been the acoustic session for the day. And this is a real instrument. It's a real instrument. Let's go.
Thank you.
the majors. Ice cream sneakers, I signed my first skater. You could pay three and buy yourself some babesters. Bulletproof on the t-shirts because they hate us. Do like Snoop say, step your game up. Double duck a boat, Mediterranean up. D-class, action cuts, tuck your chain up. Liberace fingers, rain up. Just last week, I was out in Aspen. Me and Puff hopping off the plane, both us laughing. Before that, I was out in Italy. Retired heartthrobs could not get rid of me. Up and down a telegram, me and like 10 hoes. Call from the cell phone, give me that info. I know what you're thinking, yeah, me too. Okay, everybody needs to be too.
Appreciate you, man.